the generation that you locked in the basement while movement conversations were going on upstairs. We are the generation that you told to be afraid of our light, our darkness, who we came to love. But we are here today to join in a conversation that will shake the very foundations of this Capitol.
That was Philip Agnew of the Dream Defenders, who just ended a 31-day occupation of Florida Governor Rick Scott's office, speaking over the weekend in Washington, D.C., nearly 50 years after the March on Washington. Joining me now is civil rights activist Merle Evers Williams, widow of slain civil rights leader Medgar Evers, founder and chairman of the Medgar and Merle Evers Institute and former NAACP chair. The one and only Philip Agnew, executive director of Dream Defenders, as you just saw him there, civil rights group, and Congresswoman Karen Bass, for Democrat from California and a member of the Congressional Black Caucus. Ms. Evers Williams, I have to start with you and ask about what it has been like to relive 50 years ago when that time came so fresh off the worst day in your life.
Quite honestly, it's been very difficult, but it's been very encouraging and exciting, all in the same. Let's go back. Medgar had been assassinated about a month before the March on Washington. One of the most tragic and unnerving experiences of my life and of my children. He came home from a meeting holding t-shirts that read Jim Crow Must Go. And as he got out of the car, he was shot in the back. We heard the rifle shot. The children ran to the bathroom and tried to get into the tub. It had been described as the safest place in the house. Medgar had taught them that. I went to the front door. The force of the bullet had pushed him forward in his car, and with the strength of whatever, he was able to move himself to the door with his keys in his hand. That's what we saw. I must tell you, at that point in time, all of the civil rights activities disappeared. Mm-hmm. It was the loss of my husband and my children's father. We got through the first funeral. He was buried at Arlington Cemetery. And my life as a widow became front page. So today, I felt myself going through so many emotions. That of being so proud of seeing young people step up, a younger generation step up and seize the moment and the opportunity, and having that feeling that everything is not lost. By golly, we have such a bright future here with these young people. But also, in the back of my mind, there were all of these emotions. When I saw the King children, I became very full, because I remembered Coretta Scott King, as well as Dr. King, and how much they wanted that family unit together, how much they had suffered of hearing the Reverend Bernice King speak and deliver such a forceful message. It reminded me of a father, and I felt this sense of pride with that. So I've had all of these mixed emotions.
Philip, when you hear that, one of the things that's been striking to me about the Dream Defenders is how clearly and forthrightly you place yourself in the tradition of, yes, of the civil rights struggle, yes, of direct action, direct nonviolent action. Mm-hmm. How do you feel being here, and when you hear the story of Medgar Evers, mm-hmm, knowing the line of sacrifice that has, right, come before you?
You know, I speak for myself and others and say we're just humbled to be here. The civil rights movement is our compass. It's our blueprint. It's the reason for being. It's the reason why we're here. And it provides us, we're blessed with having that as a compass, a due north for us. And so it's humbling to be here. It's humbling to hear you speak so highly of us. And really the work that we have to do is sadly reminiscent of the work that was spoken about in the I Have a Dream speech.
Well, one of the things I think that's interesting is you did this occupation, the Dream Defenders did this occupation for a special session, and then a law named after Trayvon Martin, and racial profiling, and the school to prison pipeline. Are you reinventing direct action? Are you going back and reading the own manuals? Are,
right,
you learning
the... Right. The way we look at it is, you know, we've got a car, and that car was built very well. But we've got the benefit of some GPS now, anti-lock brakes, and technology that we have to use at our disposal. So no, we're not reinventing the wheel, but we're using everything at our disposal to make sure that our car goes fast, our car goes far, and that we see victory in everything that we're doing.
Congresswoman, there were, I think, 4 African-American members of Congress on the day that Dr. King gave his, gave his speech. There are north of, I guess there's 44 today. How do you understand yourself as someone who is both, in some senses, you inherit the tradition of outside direct action activism, and you also are within the halls of power yourself?
Exactly. Well, it's absolutely what shaped my life. I mean, I remember 50 years ago, I was 9 years old, but I remember it very well. And you have 2.5 generations here, because it was the struggles of the civil rights movement that absolutely shaped my life and made me make a commitment at a very young age that I was going to devote my life to fighting for social and economic justice. And so I spent many years before being in office, being involved in direct action, studied the civil rights movement, and have spent a great deal of time trying to raise the next generation of activists.
How does the psychological experience of being the person who is sitting in a politician's office and being the person who's going to work in the politician's office, how does that change you? How do you view that now? Is there a part of you that changes internally?
Well, there is a part of my behavior maybe that changes, but not my gut, not my soul, not my principles. And so to me, I fundamentally believe the way you bring about true change is through an inside and an outside strategy. Yeah. And so direct action, community organizing, I've had a ball trying to apply it in a legislative context, and there is absolutely a way to do it. And so I think it's very consistent. I love your GPS.
Yeah, thank you.
do you think, one of the things that I think, when you go back to the actual history of this, was one of the things that they had to do with the speech was press on allies, right? I mean, there were allies in power who were sympathetic to the movement, but also were sympathetic to the movement, but didn't want to move too fast and lose too many Southern Dixiecrat votes, right?
That's true. But it's something about momentum. When it starts, it's difficult to slow it down, particularly if it's for the right cause. And this is the case. And to see what is happening today, if I may turn to you and say your generation, I am just so happy and pleased to see what's happening.
Can you feel that momentum when it's happening? Do you know the momentum is happening when you feel it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Absolutely, you do.
I think all you have to do, if I can, all you have to do is look around the country. Right. And you can see it in different pockets. And there's been a long-running question, where are the young people at? And I think a lot of young people are saying, we're here. We're here. We've been in North Carolina defending voting rights, you know. We've been here in Florida fighting against racial oppression. We've been in Ohio fighting for fair wages. And so we're here, and you can feel it, and you can see it, and I think we're in a very interesting time.
And the skill of an organizer is to always have your pulse on the people so that you know when that is happening.
Yes.
But even though I sit in the House of Representatives, I think the outside pressure is absolutely critical.
Does it bother you when you get outside pressure?
No, it doesn't bother me.
You are genuine. Are you telling me the honest truth?
I am absolutely telling you.
I feel like every politician, even the ones in their heart of hearts, are there.
No.
That there's some part of you that thinks, oh man, you make my life so much easier.
They're supposed to hold me accountable. That's why I love to have town halls.
But one of the things that I hope for is that there will be more and more publicity on what our younger people are doing today. It's absolutely necessary to move forward.
And there is a lot of really exciting stuff, Dream Defenders being just one of them. Civil rights activist Merle Evers Williams, it's such a great, great honor to have you here. Philip Agnew from Dream Defenders and Congresswoman Karen Bass.